Lutheran Church and Campus Center. I am Amy Thorin, the pastor and director here. You on the back, if you turn around on the back and see that, we would love your feedback on that. And the purple sheet, if you have a minute, we would also appreciate hearing from you where you heard about this program this evening. And there's a basket right there at the entrance to our sanctuary where you can just drop this when you're done. We would appreciate that a lot. St. Andrews has been hosting these conversation nights, these lectures slash conversation nights about religion and science for about 5 years now. And we are very intentional about it because we want this dialogue to continue, and we really want to break kind of the cultural narrative that suggests that these are mutually exclusive categories. We are still the Institute for Genomic Biology. It's right there. Look at that. I don't even have to say it. I myself wanted to be an entomologist when I was a kid, so I am particularly eager for this evening's presentation. So thank you so much for being with us, Gina. So we always put our speakers through just a mini interview, and so we just have a few questions to kind of break the ice and get us warmed up for the evening. And the first question is, we wondered if you would just tell a story about how and why you became interested in your material and in your research.
Yeah, so I first fell in love with honeybees when I was 18 years old, so quite a ways ago. And this was an accidental discovery, accidental exposure to honeybees. I was working on a kibbutz in Israel, picking grapefruits at the time, and bored to tears with the grapefruits. Nothing against grapefruits, but I was doing it for at least a month or two, grapefruits, so I said sure. And I remember the very first day I was just smitten by bees, said I want to work with bees the rest of my life as a kid of 18 years old. And I proceeded to let my parents know back in Buffalo, New York. Now, for the youth in the audience, these were conversations that took place on a time scale of weeks via something known as a letter in the post. So that's, I understand I'm dating myself, but that is the reality. And my parents were first, disappointed. No doctor, no lawyer. Bees, you know, where do we go wrong? But then my mother recovered and said, well, sounds like you know, that's what I did. Then the last part of the story is most biologists fall in love with a question in science, and then they find the right study system in order to address that question. There are a small number of biologists that fall in love with an organism first and then have to figure out how to make a living with that organism, how to study that organism. So I was in that latter category, and I soon realized that honeybees were great to be able to study social organization and how it is that a tiny brain the size of a grass seed is able to, when it resides inside, also by engineering standards that have to do with the complexity of a group organization. And those parameters have to do with are there, and how resilient is a particular corporate or communal structure to perturbation. By all of those sort of standard engineering metrics, honeybee colonies hold their own. With the other most complex animal in a few minutes has provided the tools to be able to address problems that previously have been intractable.
Church, and that we probably have many people of many different faiths and perhaps no religious affiliation, which is fantastic, aren't with your research.
So, I would say a couple of things. First of all, we are of human nature in the animal world, I think can pose some challenges or can provide some comfort to people depending on perspectives. That's number one. And number two, in order to do that, One needs to have a very, to people depending on their religious perspectives. So those would be the reasons.
Great, thank you. Again, we will have more time for conversation later this evening. Kind of a final question, which might be more of a lead-in question, is what do you find is of ultimate concern in your research for
this, the delicate balance between competition and cooperation, between selfish behavior and altruistic behavior. And I think we are all very interested in asking and understanding what is the basis for that. I think we all have an intuitive feel that the balance is pretty delicate between those two in most human endeavors. And as a biologist, I'm interested in understanding whether there's some biological insights into that delicate balance. And if there are, could they then be developed so that we have a better means of encouraging cooperation? We certainly need more of that. With that warming us up, why don't we get started? Let me say that I am happy to conduct this in a very informal way. And so if there's questions along the way, please feel free to ask those. So here's my title, and we're going to be using honeybees and the new science of genomics to ask the question about the roots of social life, or me to we, as I call it. So let's just start off with the big picture. I think we can all agree that societies and the forces that create societies, and I'll use the term social evolution for that, has given rise to some really incredible traits that have changed the face of the planet for better and for worse. Language, agriculture, and warfare, three social evolution. So what's interesting, and what motivates tonight's talk, is that these traits do not only appear in human society. They are present in another group of organisms on the planet, the insect societies. And by insect societies, I refer primarily to ants, bees, termites, and wasps. Ants, bees, and wasps are cousins to each other. They're in the same, evolved from cockroaches, and have a very completely different evolutionary history, but nevertheless, they have converged on some basic traits that are in common with the ants, bees, and the wasps. So here we have examples of these traits now in the insect societies. So recall the three. So language, we have dance language of the honeybee, which we're going to talk about. It's the subject of the second part of the talk. But just to plant the seeds, honeybees are able to communicate distance, direction, and efficiency. That's about 50%. So 50% of the information is communicated. And just to give you something to look forward to, I will make a joke about that later. So 50%, and that's the dance language of the honeybee. As a result of their dance language, they're able to themselves and go to where the flowers are. That allows them to be our most important pollinator on the planet. They account for $30 billion a year of food produced in America alone every year. One third of our food is due to honeybee and other pollination, other insect pollination. So very important, and based on the efficiency with which they can forage, which is based on their use of a language to talk to each other, to get each other to go to the right place at the right time. So that's language. Couple of examples of the other traits from the ant world, agriculture. We have leafcutter ants. You'll notice the picture here. They're carrying pieces of leaf, but these are tropical ants. But they are not eating the leaves. They take them back to the nest, and they grow fungus on the leaves, and then they eat the fungus. So they collect the leaves, they cut the leaves into particular sizes. Different ants that are different sizes cut different pieces of a different size to generation. So if you study the microbial or the fungal composition, of different colonies. It really will be like, this is that family's culture, this is that a complete agricultural system. They have fertilizer, they have herbicides, and they harvest different size. They have not yet been discovered to wear John Deere caps and tractors. That's all that's missing from their agricultural system. So agriculture, several hundred million years before humans ever invented it. And then finally, warfare. Yes, social insects have warfare. These are honeypot ants from the desert southwest. And take a look at two things. First of all, hopefully you see that some are black and some are red. So these are from different colonies and there's some variation in their color. The next thing is a little more subtle to see. See if you can pick it out. No, it's not your imagination. These ants kind of look like they're standing on tippy toes, or if they're any entomologist or would-be entomologist, tippy tarsi, right here. And that is exactly what they are doing. They are trying to appear bigger than they really are. So these and these are ants that come together in particular place size, the relative size of the ants, and I'll explain to you why that is in a moment. So we don't understand what's going on there, but we do see what the outcome is. After they've been checking each other out for a while, the ants from the bigger colony will go home and will mobilize to have a raid, to raid the ants from the smaller colony. Meanwhile, the ants from the smaller colony go back home and they mobilize a defense. They shut down the entrances and they move the queen to a more secure place and they get ready to be attacked. So something transpires here that leads to a form of warfare that's actually a form of slavery, where the ants from the bigger colony will attack the ants from the smaller colony and remove the babies and take them back to their own colony where they grow up. They have not known Joseph, they don't know where they are, and they just then work in that other colony, essentially enslaved in a biological sense. That is, they are performing activities for the good of another family, not their own family. So they're not passing along descendants of their genes in any way at all. What's the missing piece? The missing piece is that the size of the ants is actually a good indicator of the size of their colony. Big colonies acting with ants that are smaller at these locations. You say, my colony is probably bigger. So, examples of these particular traits. So we see them in both human society and insect society, leading to a question, to questions along these lines. Are these nothing more than little people, or I should say, are people nothing more than big bees? So these are the questions that we're going to consider tonight. Now, we have one answer to this, which suggests that, there are approaches addressing an answer to this. And I must say, I think has come up with an approach that's quite nuanced and quite useful in going forward and considering questions that can be inflammatory or ridiculous. And the social insects, and then on the other side, our own society. And the problem is right here. The last common ancestor of insects and vertebrates, and particularly the primate lineage that we have evolved from, to live 600 million years ago with a very, very rudimentary brain, very simple brain, not much of a social life at all, as far as we can tell, maybe no social life. And yet that's the last common ancestor giving rise to these societies, these advanced societies, human society, and insect society. Moreover, in addition to these humble roots, it's very limited. These are the only known cases of the evolution of advanced society. So all the rest of life, we don't see these kinds of forms of life. And so then that raises the question of how do we understand the relationships between these two forms of life. insect societies and the human societies. Now, it was a stark choice between two possibilities. One is called conservation, and the other is called convergence. Conservation means, in biology, when you're looking at a trait, which is advanced society, if that trait is evolutionarily conserved, what that means then is that the last common ancestor also had it, and it has been inherited through generation and generation and generation, and that's why you see it. But when you see a pattern like this, where it's unlikely that there was anything going on in the last common ancestor, traditional biology would have only one other in these organisms, maybe because of some kind of shared environment, some kind of ecology that had some kind of problem in nature that had to be overcome. If it's, and the two implications of the two are very different, if it's conservation, then you can expect that there's a lot of shared machinery going on with respect to what makes this society tick and what makes the other society tick. Whereas if it's convergence, there's no reason to expect anything because they evolved independently. They are similar solutions to different environmental, ecological problems, and they're nice to compare. They arrive at their solutions independently. So what I want to tell you is that genomics has given us a third way, allows us to learn perhaps more from one as it relates to the other. So that's what I want to tell you about, this third way. So the way we approach this, so we're talking about behavior, so we obviously have to get into the brain. And the way we approach the systems, one is the structure of the brain itself, the neurons, what they do, their firing, all of their electrical activity, all the stuff, like when you see an MRI scan, a part of the brain lighting up, you know, you see that in the newspapers a lot, that's the neuron activity. Underneath the neuron activity is DNA, genes, and gene activity. And the problem that I've just described is an old problem. The superficial similarities between the honeybee society, the ant society, and the human society were known to Proverbs, right? You just saw that quote. It's not a new thing that there's some similarities there. People have noticed that for some time. But we could never get any traction in understanding evolutionary relationships between them because we only had either the conservation or convergence approach. And until genomics, we couldn't get any traction by studying the structure of the brain because for whatever reason we don't understand yet, it's not as easy to compare and contrast brain structures as it is to compare and contrast genes. And so it's only with the advent of the new science of genomics do we have the tools to be able to compare brains and behavior. Look at the brain of a human, and two scientists could say, I think these two structures are similar, and another scientist would say, I don't think they're similar, and there's no way to arbitrate that. So that's not good science. It can make for good polemics, because the scientists, we scientists can be sure of ourselves and be quite confident and assert that we're right and the other person's wrong, but there's no independent way of doing so. Genes, on the other hand, one can look at similarities of genes, how similar they are to each other across species, and that gives us an understanding of what they do in different species, and you'll see how important. Genomics is a new science. Let me just say a few words about it, because you may not be yet that familiar with it. So what genomics refers to is a study of genomes. Okay, great, another nerdy definition. What's a genome? A genome is turning them on and off, where and when, you know, all the approaches that a newspaper reporter takes, that's what we're talking about for regulating genes. Who, what, when, where. And so we have pieces of DNA that do that, and then the genes themselves. Genes encode, proteins build the body, they run the body, they repair the body, and that goes for all bodies, whether it's a plant, or a human, or a bee, or a bacteria. So genomics is the study of genomes. It's an expansive science. It's a big picture science, whereas molecular biology has been alive and well for some time, all about studying individual genes. Genomics is about studying all genes. So think of molecular biology as retail and genomics as wholesale. Big picture, take in the whole thing. So genomics is about studying all the genes, and then there's one more level of big picture. One genome's not enough, so you study lots of genomes, whether it's lots of genomes from the same species or lots of genomes from different species. So genomics is a mindset. It's basically emerging both as a set of technologies to study the genes and genomes, and having the tools to be able to get at it. So I am fond of a quote from the oral law from the Old Testament, and that is, you don't empty an ocean with a spoon. The founders of genomics couldn't have put it better. That is the mindset. So it's very interesting, if you're interested in the development of science. Genomics is not developing as a classical discipline or subdiscipline within biology, like development or behavior or neuroscience or ecology, those kinds of entomology, those kinds of things. It's developing as an enabling science to help make all the other sciences better. And if you don't believe me, just kind of go around informally from now on and see how many little girls and boys tell you when you ask what you want to be when you grow up, how many of them say, I want to be a genomicist? Even if they could pronounce it, I guarantee you they're not going to be saying that. But evolutionary biologists are using genomics, developmental biologists are using genomics, biomedical scientists are using genomics, and they're using it in two ways. One is a set of techniques, but also as a mindset of how do we study this problem big. So last comment I'll make in this digression, then I'll come back, is right now they're probably on the entire planet, maybe less than a million human genomes that are sequenced. But within a couple of years from now, there will be hundreds of millions, and maybe even more. There are some countries with very large populations that are thinking about having all their babies born, having their genome sequenced. I speak of China and India. And if that happens, we're going to get into the billions very soon. And that's what's going to happen sooner or later, whether it's in the next few years or a few years later, that is going to happen. I'm also helping to lead an effort to sequence all life forms on the planet, all plants and animals, 1.4 million described species. And again, it sounds very exciting, and it is really very exciting, but it's going to happen one way or the other. So I figure, why not push it a little sooner? So that's a brief digression on genomics. Any questions about genomics? Okay. So,
well, there was one.
Yes, I'm sorry. Excuse me.
When did genomics start? How long ago?
So genomics as a science is probably about 25 years old. Like all other major endeavors, there was a gestation period and people were talking about it, but it really has been, in other words, what really catalyzed it was were conversations on sequencing the human genome, how important that would be to understand better who we are, and lay the groundwork for a new form of medicine. Those conversations started taking place probably about 30, 35 years ago, and the science really took shape about 20, 25 years ago. And a little bit of local information, we here at the Woese Institute for Genomic Biology like to think, and with good reason, that we are in one of the preeminent genomics institutes in the country. And one reason, in addition to the great faculty and the great support that we get from the university, we got in early, and it sometimes pays to get in early. So we had an idea for the
base by base, and know the activity of the genes they might have microwave and everything.
Oh yeah, definitely. So yeah, so
these
two
different things in a way.
Very different. Yeah. So that goes to you'll recall I said DNA, RNA, and protein. So if you're just focusing on the genome itself, the genome is DNA. And there, what you're looking at is the sequence of the DNA. So DNA is sort of the script of life. So you read it off and you create eventually proteins. The intermediary is the RNA. RNA, if DNA is kind of the script, RNA is kind of an improvisation because it's sensitive, it's not only carrying out the instructions of the DNA, it's also sensitive to the environment. It's where the rubber meets the road and you get an interaction there. It's why nature and nurture are all about the genome, but not in the way that you may think, because there is a strong role for the environment in shaping gene activity. So DNA is sequence, RNA is the activity of the genes. Are they turned on? Are they turned off? Are they turned on really high? Are they completely shut off? Are they expressed or turned on in this part of the body, this part of the brain, and not that part? All of that is about RNA. And then it's what happens with the RNA that gives rise to the proteins. And the proteins are the workhorses that actually build the body. Two lessons tonight. One, nature builds diverse social brains with common genetic building blocks. This is the third way that I spoke about. This is called the toolkit argument, which is that you can have independent evolutions of a particular set of traits, in this case, advanced society, right? We agreed that the marine flatworm doesn't have much of a social life, so these can't be conserved. But I will show you some genomic data that support the idea that even though the honeybee society and the human society are not genetic building blocks. That's the toolkit argument. That's the third way. So we're splitting the difference, if you will. And then once I show you this, that there are common building blocks, we will focus on one particular common building block, which is not a gene, but a set of genes that together controls the reward system of the brain. And I hope to convince you that the reward system can be hijacked and shaped to promote altruistic behavior out of roots that are selfish. So that's what we're doing. Okay, so we'll start with the first one. And here's the question. Do brain responses to social information involve evolutionary conserved mechanisms? So I said that society, advanced society, is very rare. We only see it in the species that I mentioned before, social insects, and the humans. And so studying advanced society would be a little more difficult because there are fewer species that we have to study. However, if you look at social attributes, you can then find that much more universally. And that is the ability to they can respond to a threat. They can identify it as a threat. They can distinguish between friend and foe and respond appropriately. So this is our interdisciplinary group. So I wear two hats at the IGB. I'm the director of the IGB. I'm also part of one of our teams. There are no individual scientists at the IGB. It's a sort of an experiment in team science. It's very different than the traditional approach. This is our team that studies gene networks in neural and developmental plasticity. And it's composed of scientists that study animals, like myself. So Lisa Stubbs studies mice, Allison Bell studies stickleback fish, and then we have computational biologists, physicists, computer scientists, and so forth. Saurabh Sinha from computer science, Jian Ma from bioengineering, and Yoshi Ono from physics to help us analyze the mounds of data, because genomics has given rise to big data problems in biology, big data challenges, and we form these productive connections with computer scientists, with physicists, with others that have the facility to develop analytical techniques. Because don't forget, we're not studying one gene now, we're studying maybe 10,000 genes. So it gets complicated. So what we did was we came up with an experiment to address this question. So that experiment was social challenge that's appropriate for all three species, but similar enough to be able to allow reasonable comparisons across the species. So we had territory intrusion in an aquarium for sticklebacks, Allison Bell's lab. Territory do just one individual, they have to be in a group. So this was in a lab cage, a group of individuals, in all cases putting in a foreign individual, an intruder, someone they don't know, someone they're not related to, and getting their response. Want to go back? So conceptually then, we present them with a social stimulus, in this case an intruder.
Technology has been... has come together. Welcome. I'd like to welcome you all to St. Andrew's Lutheran Church and Campus Center. I am Amy Thorin, the pastor and director here. You on the back, if you turn around on the back and see that, we would love your feedback on that. And the purple sheet, if you have a minute, we would also appreciate hearing from you where you heard about this program this evening. And there's a basket right there at the entrance to our sanctuary where you can just drop this when you're done. We would appreciate that a lot. St. Andrew's has been hosting these conversation nights, these lectures / conversation nights about religion and science for about 5 years now. And we are very intentional about it because we want this dialogue to continue. And we really want to break kind of the cultural narrative that suggests that these are mutually exclusive categories. We are still the Institute for Genomic Biology. It's right there. Look at that. I don't even have to say it. I myself wanted to be an entomologist when I was a kid, so I am particularly eager for this evening's presentation. So thank you so much for being with us, Gina. We always put our speakers through just a mini interview, and so we just have a few questions to kind of break the ice and get us warmed up for the evening. And the first question is, we wondered if you would just tell a story about how and why you became interested in your material and in your research.
Yeah, so I first fell in love with honeybees when I was 18 years old, so quite a ways ago. And this was an accidental discovery, accidental exposure to honeybees. I was working on a kibbutz in Israel, picking grapefruits at the time, and bored to tears with the grapefruits. Nothing against grapefruits, but I was doing it for at least a month or two of grapefruits, so I said sure. And I remember the very first day I was just smitten by bees, said I want to work with bees the rest of my life as a kid of 18. And I proceeded to let my parents know back in Buffalo, New York. Now, for the youth in the audience, these were conversations that took place on a time scale of weeks via something known as a letter that was sent in the post. So that's, I understand I'm dating myself, but that is the reality. And my parents were first, disappointed. No doctor, no lawyer. Bees, you know, where do we go wrong? But then my mother recovered and said, well, sounds like you know, that's what I did. Then the last part of the story is most biologists fall in love with a question in science, and then they find the right study system in order to address that question. There are a small number of biologists that fall in love with an organism first and then have to figure out how to make a living with that organism by studying that organism. So I was in that latter category, and I soon realized that honeybees were great to be able to study social organization and how it is that a tiny grain the size of a grass seed is able to, when it resides inside, also by engineering standards that have to do with the complexity of a group organization. And those parameters have to do with are there, and how resilient is a particular corporate or communal structure to perturbation. By all of those sort of standard engineering metrics, honeybee colonies hold their own with the other most complex animal that in a few minutes has provided the tools to be able to address problems that previously have been intractable.
Church, and that we probably have many people of many different faiths and perhaps no religious affiliation, which is fantastic. Armed with your research.
So I would say a couple of things. First of all, we are a piece of human nature in the animal world. I think can pose some challenges or can provide some comfort to people depending on perspectives. That's number one. And number two, in order to do that, one needs to have a very to people depending on their religious perspectives. So those would be the reasons.
Great, thank you. Again, we will have more time for conversation later this evening. Kind of a final question, which might be more of a lead-in question, is what do you find is of ultimate concern in your research for
this, the delicate balance between competition and cooperation, between selfish behavior and altruistic behavior. And I think we are all very interested in asking and understanding what is the basis for that. I think we all have an intuitive feel that the balance is pretty delicate between those two in most human endeavors. And as a biologist, I'm interested in understanding whether there's some biological insights into that delicate balance. And if there are, could they then be developed so that we have a better means of encouraging cooperation? We certainly need more of that. With that warming us up, why don't we get started? Let me say that I am happy to conduct this in a very informal way. And so if there's questions along the way, please feel free to ask those. So here's my title, and we're going to be using honeybees and the new science of genomics to ask the question about the roots of social life, or me to we, as I call it. So let's just start off with the big picture. I think we can all agree that societies and the forces that create societies, and I'll use the term social evolution for that, has given rise to some really incredible traits that have changed the face of the planet for better and for worse. Language, agriculture, and warfare, three social evolution. So what's interesting, and what motivates tonight's talk, is that these traits do not only appear in human society. They are present in another group of organisms on the planet, the insect societies. And by insect societies, I refer primarily to ants, bees, termites, and wasps. Ants, bees, and wasps are cousins to each other. They're in the same, evolved from cockroaches, and have a very completely different evolutionary history, but nevertheless, they have converged on some basic traits that are in common with the ants, bees, and the wasps. So here we have examples of these traits now in the insect societies. So recall the three. So language, we have dance language of the honeybee, which we're going to talk about. It's the subject of the second part of the talk. But just to plant the seeds, honeybees are able to communicate distance, direction, and efficiency. That's about 50%. So 50% of the information is communicated. And just to give you something to look forward to, I will make a joke about that later. percent, and that's the dance language of the honeybee. As a result of their dance language, they're able to ask themselves and go to where the flowers are that allows them to be our most important pollinator on the planet. They account for $30 billion a year of food produced in America alone every year. One third of our food is due to honeybee and other pollination, other insect pollination. So very important, and based on the efficiency with which they can forage, which is based on their use of a language to talk to each other, to get each other to go to the right place at the right time. So that's language. A couple of examples of the other traits from the ant world. Agriculture, we have leafcutter ants. You'll notice the picture here. They're carrying pieces of leaf, but these are tropical ants, but they are not eating the leaves. They take them back to the nest, and they grow fungus on the leaves, and then they eat the fungus. So they collect the leaves, they cut the leaves into particular sizes. Different ants that are different sizes cut different pieces of a different size to generation. So if you study the microbial or the fungal composition of different colonies, it really will be like, this is that family's culture, this is that of a complete agricultural system. They have fertilizer, they have herbicides, and they harvest different size. They have not yet been discovered to wear John Deere caps and tractors. That's all that's missing from their agricultural system. So agriculture, several hundred million years before humans ever invented it. And then finally, warfare. Yes, social insects have warfare. These are honeypot ants from the desert southwest. And take a look at two things. First of all, hopefully you see that some are black and some are red. So these are from different colonies, and there's some variation in their color. The next thing is a little more subtle to see if you can pick it out. Though it's not your imagination, these ants kind of look like they're standing on tippy toes, or if they're any entomologists, or would-be entomologists, tippy tarsi, right here. And that is exactly what they are doing. They are trying to appear bigger than they really are. So these and these are ants that are that come together in particular place size, the relative size of the ants, and I'll explain to you why that is in a moment. So we don't understand what's going on there, but we do see what the outcome is. After they've been checking each other out for a while, the ants from the bigger colony will go home and will mobilize to have a raid, to raid the ants from the smaller colony. Meanwhile, the ants from the smaller colony go back home and they mobilize a defense. They shut down the entrances and they move the queen to a more secure place and they get ready to be attacked. So something transpires here that leads to a form of warfare that's actually a form of slavery, where the ants from the bigger colony will attack the ants from the smaller colony and remove the babies and take them back to their own colony where they grow up. They have not known Joseph, they don't know where they are, and they just then work in that other colony, essentially enslaved in a biological sense. That is, they are performing activities for the good of another family, not their own family. So they're not passing along descendants of their genes in any way at all. What's the missing piece? The missing piece is that the size of the ants is actually a good indicator of the size of their colony. Big colonies acting with ants that are smaller at these locations. You say, oh, okay, my colony is probably bigger. So, examples of these particular traits. So we see them in both human society and insect society, leading to questions along these lines. Are these nothing more than little people, or I should say, are people nothing more than big bees? So these are the questions that we're going to consider tonight. Now, we have one answer to this, which suggests that, there are approaches addressing an answer to this. And I must say, I think has come up with an approach that's quite nuanced and quite useful in going forward, and considering questions that can be inflammatory or ridiculous. And the social insects, and then on the other side, our own society. And the problem is right here. The last common ancestor of insects and vertebrates, and particularly the primate lineage that we have evolved from, to live 600 million years ago with a very, very rudimentary brain, very simple brain, not much of a social life at all, as far as we can tell, maybe no social life. And yet that's the last common ancestor giving rise to these societies, these advanced societies, human society and insect society. Moreover, in addition to these humble roots, it's very limited. These are the only known cases of the evolution of advanced society. So all the rest of life, we don't see these kinds of forms of life. And so then that raises the question of how do we understand the relationships between these two forms of life, the insect societies and the human societies. Now, it was a stark choice between two possibilities. One is called conservation, and the other is called convergence. Conservation means, in biology, when you're looking at a trait, which is advanced society, if that trait is evolutionarily conserved, what that means then is that the last common ancestor also had it, and it has been inherited through generation and generation and generation, and that's why you see it. But when you see a pattern like this, where it's unlikely that there was anything going on in the last common ancestor, traditional biology would have only one other in these organisms, maybe because of some kind of shared environment, some kind of ecology that had some kind of problem in nature that had to be overcome. If it's, and the two implications of the two are very different. If it's conservation, then you can expect that there's a lot of shared machinery going on with respect to what makes this society tick and what makes the other society tick. Whereas if it's convergence, there's no reason to expect anything because they evolved independently. They are similar solutions to different environmental, ecological problems, and they're nice to compare. They arrive at their solutions independently. So what I want to tell you is that genomics has given us a third way, allows us to learn perhaps more from one as it relates to the other. So that's what I want to tell you about, this third way. So the way we approach this, so we're talking about behavior, so we obviously have to get into the brain. And the way we approach the systems, one is the structure of the brain itself, the neurons, what they do, their firing, all of their electrical activity, all the stuff, like when you see an MRI scan, a part of the brain lighting up, you know, you see that in the newspapers a lot, that's the neuron activity. Underneath the neuron activity is DNA, genes, and gene activity. And the problem that I've just described is an old problem. The superficial similarities between the honeybee society, the ant society, and the human society were known to Proverbs, right? You just saw that quote. It's not a new thing that there's some similarities there. People have noticed that for some time. But we could never get any traction in understanding evolutionary relationships between them because we only had either the conservation or convergence approach. And until genomics, we couldn't get any traction by studying the structure of the brain because, for whatever reason we don't understand yet, it's not as easy to compare and contrast brain structures as it is to compare and contrast genes. And so, it's only with the advent of the new science of genomics do we have the tools to be able to compare brains and behavior. Look at the brain of a human, and two scientists could say, I think these two structures are similar, and another scientist would say, I don't think they're similar, and there's no way to arbitrate that. So that's not good science. It can make for good polemics, because we scientists can be sure of ourselves and be quite confident and assert that we're right and the other person's wrong, but there's no independent way of doing so. Genes, on the other hand, one can look at similarities of genes, how similar they are to each other across species, and that gives us an understanding of what they do in different species, and you'll see how important. Genomics is a new science. Let me just say a few words about it, because you may not be yet that familiar with it. So what genomics refers to is the study of genomes. Great, another nerdy definition. What's a genome? A genome is turning them on and off, where and when, you know, all the approaches that a newspaper reporter takes, that's what we're talking about for regulating genes. Who, what, when, where. And so we have pieces of DNA that do that, and then the genes themselves. Genes encode, proteins build the body, they run the body, they repair the body. And that goes for all bodies, whether it's a plant, or a human, or a bee, or a bacteria. So genomics is the study of genomes. It's an expansive science. It's a big picture science. Whereas molecular biology has been alive and well for some time, all about studying individual genes, genomics is about studying all genes. So think of molecular biology as retail and genomics as wholesale. Big picture, take in the whole thing. So genomics is about studying all the genes, and then there's one more level of big picture. One genome's not enough, so you study lots of genomes, whether it's lots of genomes from the same species or lots of genomes from different species. So genomics is a mindset. It's basically emerging both as a set of technologies to study the genes and genomes, and having the tools to be able to get at it. So I'm fond of a quote from the oral law from the Old Testament, and that is, you don't empty an ocean with a spoon. The founders of genomics couldn't have put it better. That is the mindset. So it's very interesting if you're interested in the development of science. Genomics is not developing as a classical discipline or subdiscipline within biology, like development or behavior or neuroscience or ecology, those kinds of entomology, those kinds of things. It's developing as an enabling science to help make all the other sciences better. And if you don't believe me, just kind of go around informally from now on and see how many little girls and boys tell you when you ask what do you want to be when you grow up, how many of them say, I want to be a genomicist? Even if they could pronounce it, I guarantee you they're not going to be saying that. But evolutionary biologists are using genomics, developmental biologists are using genomics, biomedical scientists are using genomics, and they're using it in two ways. One is a set of techniques, but also as a mindset. How do we study this problem big? So, last comment I'll make in this digression, then I'll come back, is right now they're probably on the entire planet, maybe less than a million human genomes that are sequenced, but within a couple of years from now, there will be hundreds of millions, and maybe even more. There are some countries with very large populations that are thinking about having all their babies born, having their genome sequenced. China and India. And if that happens, we're going to get into the billions very soon. And that's what's going to happen sooner or later, whether it's in the next few years or a few years later, that is going to happen. I'm also helping to lead an effort to sequence all life forms on the planet, all plants and animals, 1.4 million described species. And again, it sounds very exciting, and it is really very exciting, but it's going to happen one way or the other. So I figured, why not push it a little
So that's a brief digression on genomics. Any questions about genomics? Okay, so back.
Well, there was one.
Yes, I'm sorry. Excuse me.
When did genomics start? How long ago?
So genomics as a science is probably about 25 years old. Like all other, you know, major endeavors, there was a gestation period and people were talking about it, but it really has been, in other words, what really catalyzed it was were conversations on sequencing the human genome, how important that would be to understand better who we are and lay the groundwork for a new form of medicine. Those conversations started taking place probably about 30, 35 years ago, and the science really took shape about 20, 25 years ago. And a little bit of local information, we here at the Woese Institute for Genomic Biology like to think, and with good reason, that we are in one of the preeminent genomics institutes in the country. And one reason, in addition to the great faculty and the great support that we get from the university, we got in early, and it sometimes pays to get in early. So we had an idea for the
base by base, mm-hmm. and the activity of the genes, they might microwave and everything.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, definitely. So yeah, so this
two
is
different things in play.
Very different. Yeah. So that goes to you'll recall I said DNA, RNA, and protein. So if you're just focusing on the genome itself, the genome is DNA. And there, what you're looking at is the sequence of the DNA. So DNA is sort of the script of life. So you read it off and you create eventually proteins. The intermediary is the RNA. RNA, if DNA is kind of the script, RNA is kind of an improvisation because it's sensitive not only carrying out the instructions of the DNA, it's also sensitive to the environment. It's where the rubber meets the road, and you get an interaction there. It's why nature and nurture are all about the genome, but not in the way that you may think, because there is a strong role for the environment in shaping gene activity. So DNA is sequence, RNA is the activity of the genes. Are they turned on? Are they turned off? Are they turned on really high? Are they completely shut off? Are they expressed or turned on in this part of the body, this part of the brain, and not that part? All of that is about RNA. And then it's what happens with the RNA that gives rise to the proteins. And the proteins are the workhorses that actually build the body. Two lessons tonight. One, nature builds diverse social brains with common genetic building blocks. This is the third way that I spoke about. This is called the toolkit argument, which is that you can have independent evolutions of a particular set of traits, in this case, advanced society, right? We agreed that the marine flatworm doesn't have much of a social life, so these can't be conserved. But I will show you some genomic data that support the idea that even though the honeybee society and the human society are not genetic building blocks. That's the toolkit argument. That's the third way. Sort of splitting the difference, if you will. And then, once I show you this, that there are common building blocks, we will focus on one particular common building block, which is not a gene, but a set of genes that together controls the reward system of the brain. And I hope to convince you that the reward system can be hijacked and shaped to promote altruistic behavior out of roots that are selfish. So that's what we're doing. Okay, so we'll start with the first one. And here's the question. Do brain responses to social information involve evolutionary conserved mechanisms? So I said that society, advanced society, is very rare. We only see it in the species that I mentioned before, social insects, and the humans. And so studying advanced society would be a little more difficult because there are fewer species that we have to study. However, if you look at social attribute, you can then find that much more universally. And that is the ability, they can respond to a threat. They can identify it as a threat. They can distinguish between friend and foe and respond appropriately. So this is our interdisciplinary group. So I wear two hats at the IGB. I'm the director of the IGB. I'm also part of one of our teams. There are no individual scientists at the IGB. It's a sort of an experiment in team science. It's very different than the traditional approach. This is our team that studies gene networks in neural and developmental plasticity. And it's composed of scientists that study animals, like myself. So Lisa Stubbs studies mice. Allison Bell studies stickleback fish. And then we have computational biologists, physicists, computer scientists, and so forth. Saurabh Sinha from computer science, Jian Ma from bioengineering, and Yoshi Ono from physics to help us analyze the mounds of data. Because genomics has given rise to big data problems in biology, big data challenges, and we form these productive connections with computer scientists, with physicists, with others that have the facility to develop analytical techniques. Because don't forget, we're not studying one gene now, we're studying maybe 10,000 genes. So it gets complicated. So what we did was we came up with an experiment to address this question. So that experiment was social challenge that's appropriate for all three species, but similar enough to be able to allow reasonable comparisons across the species. So we had territory intrusion in an aquarium for sticklebacks, Allison Bell's lab. Territory do just one individual, they have to be in a group. So this was in a lab cage, a group of individuals, in all cases putting in a foreign individual, an intruder, someone they don't know, someone they're not related to, and getting their response. Want to go back? Stuff in genomes that we're still under, just trying to understand. So there's two strands of DNA, and you read it in a certain direction. Turns out sometimes there are genes hidden in a strand of DNA that you have to read going the other direction. We don't understand any of that stuff. But most genes are fairly well behaved. You have a start site and kind of an end, more than you would expect by chance. So that right away says the response has some similarities to it. Then the interesting part is to say, well, what kinds of responses do you see? Some of the genes, as I said, many of them, we know the function. So who are they? And here's where we get another level of information that further strengthens the assertion that this is a similar response. So it's possible to have an overlap. So let's say out of, if there are 1,000 genes that are differentially expressed in each species, and one has, say, 350 genes that are the same, or cousins, it could be possible that when you ask, well, what are the functions of those, you have a whole story here. This panel says that there are coherent stories to this. So what this shows are these circles are clusters of genes, all of them representing the differentially expressed genes. These are clusters of genes that have the same function. Here are some of the functions. OxPhos, oxidative phosphorylation, which is part of metabolism, breaking down sugar, creating energy from it, or vice versa. Developmental pathways, transcription factors like PAX6 involved in gene regulation, and then the structure of DNA in a certain form is called, DNA is called chromatin, so the organization of DNA. These were four biological processes that had so many genes on the common list of differentially expressed genes that these terms themselves were significantly enriched in explaining or annotating this list of genes. That's why you see all these circles together. Genes like PAX6 change and become differentially expressed, and we assume that those changes in gene regulation are then what's regulating the other changes. So we see both of these going on. Getting back to one of your questions before about how do we know that the response really relates to the intruder. So I gave you some answers. One more answer is we're able to take this particular result, which is that there's a change in metabolism, use it as the basis for a treatment experiment. So we took honeybees and fruit flies and we changed their brain metabolism before they were exposed to an intruder. And we hypothesized that if this is really a response to an intruder, they will become more patient that that really was a response to the intruder. So these are toolkit kinds of genes that have functions and that are involved in somehow changing the brain in response to the intruder. Now, the last point that I want to make to understand this response is when an animal is exposed to an intruder, it responds immediately. There's a threat, there's an immediate response. Changes in gene expression take minutes to occur. We measured all of this 30 minutes after they responded. So you're right away thinking, well, this usually is predictive of another threat. And so what we're seeing here is the brain is a connection between this work and a social pathology is chronic stress. So here, the animal becomes alert and it will wear off after some period of time. But in some parts of the world, including places not too far from here, the threats don't go away, continue, and it's very debilitating. So the neurons respond immediately and orchestrate a behavioral response. But then somehow, that doesn't require any changes in gene expression, but that response triggers the change in gene expression. That's where we get this idea of two control systems. So you might admit the neurons could basically say, I got this, I don't need to tell the genome anything, the threat's gone already, and there may be no change in gene expression. But if we have the intruder who says, hey, you guys better change gene expression and stay vigilant for some period of time, because past performance is predictive of the future. So stockbrokers are right. So we can take this work, as I said, and knowing that there is a toolkit, we are emboldened to add. You see a commonality there. It's not that much of a stretch to say this must be a very conserved molecular toolkit, genetic toolkit, to this problem of responses to threats. And so therefore, if it's conserved to that extent, such a state, so I led a National Academy study, this was the subject and it was published here, without having the genomic information, this would be one of those things where some people would say, yeah, that's a really interesting idea, and others would say, are you nuts? You can't compare that. So now we can say, we don't have to debate it in that way anymore. Let's let the genes tell us. Let's let the profiles of gene expression tell us to what extent is there similarity and to what extent is there not. And on that basis, we can proceed. So that's an objective approach that is more scientific. So this is another group at the IGB. It's headed by sociologist Ruby Mendenhall, who's been studying the response to chronic deprivation in single moms in South Chicago. And we are trying to... Any questions on part one? Okay, so on to part two. So with this information that there is this kind of thing going on, that there are these toolkits, and I specifically mentioned gene regulation as one of them, transcription factors. I mentioned metabolism as another one. So these are examples of now biological processes that one can get by looking at what's known about the genes. So now that we have this approach established, let's kind of go back to the original question, which was the me to we question, the high levels of society. So we've covered something over here, very important, response to threat, but that's kind of all animals can do that. So we've established the principle here. Can we now take it to this higher level where we have hair and language, and obviously not all of the traits, social traits, have to do with cooperation, because we're talking about warfare, but language and agriculture, exquisite levels of cooperation, a lot of self-sacrifice and altruism go into making societies. So it's thought that altruism or cooperation are really social glue. So how do we get that kind of trait? Can we apply the same approach? To talk about addiction to sweets, and no one has to own up to anything tonight, you can defend yourself. So not too much of a stretch. How about this? What do people think about this? And we talk about insects, honeybees, as being addicted to sweets. How about this? Remember some of these traits? Can we talk about addiction to altruism? Now, the intuition is we all try to raise our kids to feel good when they do something for others, right? So we have an intuitive feel that the reward system, and that we can use it to socialize our kids, or at least to keep our kids from not breaking everything around, right? So it's a plastic trait. We also know from the other side that the reward system is all too susceptible to hijacking. Drugs of abuse are known to, of humans, sex and eating. These drugs will hijack that region. We also know if you put people in a brain imager and they love opera singing, the part of the brain will light, that same part of the brain will light up when they hear opera. If someone's a stamp collector, same thing. So the reward system is easily hijacked for good and for bad. We know that from humans. So the subject that we addressed in my lab was, can we develop the same concept for social insects, for honeybees, to be able to assert that you can have an evolutionary relationship to the reward system where you can make it so that it structures altruism. So here's the framing that starts to make the case for this. And the punchline is that the molecular roots of altruism lie in selfish behavior. So here are some well-known observations. When a solitary insect finds good food, she eats more, fair enough, and dance more, rather than eating more out in the field. And I'll show you evidence to say that the same to these dance more. So that's the me to we switch. So let me introduce the dance language again. This is how it looks. When a bee finds good food out in a flower, whether it's nectar or pollen, she will come back and do a series of movements that encode distance, direction, and the value of the food. So here it is schematized. She will go like that, make some waggles, circle around, make some other waggles, and the direction of the food relative to the position of the sun is encoded. The distance in terms of how long it takes to get there, how far away it is encoded by these movements. And the value of the food, how good is encoded in these movements. And that is by how active and vigorous the dances are. People have developed robot bees to be able to communicate with live bees, and it's on that basis that 50% accuracy in communication. I'll take it. That's very, very good. So this is a very effective communication system in a tiny little brain, and it exists to orchestrate altruism. Bees go out, they find food, they don't eat it themselves, they bring it back to the colony, and they tell other bees in the colony where to find that food so that the colony is able to mount a massive foraging effort. This is really important because flowers are very ephemeral. It's really difficult to make a living on flowers. They are here today and gone tomorrow. So their quality of nectar and quantity of nectar goes down, pollen also. So when bees find a good food source, it really pays for the colony to be able to share information like this so that they can all go to the best food sources and exploit that food source.
So we wanted to ask whether something about this dance communication is regulated by a neurochemical that's known to regulate selfish eating behavior. This chemical is called octopamine. It's a cousin to dopamine, which is relevant. As some of you know, dopamine is sort of like the brain's pleasure juice. When the brain is feeling pleasure, it secretes dopamine at higher levels into a particular part of the brain. Whether these are, dopamine is kind of a cousin to octopamine. It's so potent in insects that if you give it to flies and then put flies in, so flies can taste food with their feet. So if you put a fly, and then they stick their tongue out once they perceive it. If you put a fly, a normal fly, in a droplet of sugar water, it will put its tongue out once its feet taste the sugar, and then when it gets full, it'll stop. A fly that's high on octopamine will eat until it bursts, actually. That's how potent this drug is, this neurochemical is, at the system to create bees that dance more with this chemical. So here's the experimental setup, and what this is a tunnel. Here's a close-up of the tunnel. Behind here is a glass wall beehive so that the dances of the bees could be videotaped on South Campus. And this is the arrangement that we used. There was a very interesting challenge to this experiment, that this tunnel tricking the bees into thinking they've flown further than they have bears on. So we have to do the experiment in an enclosure so that we can make sure that the dances are normal and natural, because these neurochemicals, so dopamine, I said, is the brain's pleasure juice. I'm sure some of you are aware of dopamine in a different context. Anyone? Particular disease?
Parkinson's.
Affecting movement. So we wanted to make sure that if we give bees this closely related chemical, octopamine, and we see changes in dances, we wanted to be able to interpret whether that's just disinhibited motor problems or actually the bees dancing more. Our hypothesis, since octopamine makes flies eat more, is that it will make honeybees dance more. And we wanted to make sure that we could rule out motor problems as opposed to wanting to dance more. So we had this enclosed so that we knew, however, there's a problem. That's with the dance language. When bees are dancing to a feeding station or flowers that's a short distance away, those beautiful movements that you saw over and over again on the previous slide, they are not as beautiful. Distance and direction are not encoded if the distance is less than 100 meters away. So if the distance is further than 100 meters away, the bees give exquisite directions. This X number of degrees to the east of where the sun is, and such a distance. If it's less than 100 meters away, they basically tell their sisters, there's food close by, go find it, you know where to find it. So it's not, the dances are not as information-y extreme. So a scientist in Australia came to the rescue for totally different reasons and created a tunnel that tricks bees into flying, into thinking they have flown a longer distance than they have. So the experiment, the study, the question that Manyan Srinivasan was trying to address was something totally different than what we're talking about tonight. He wanted to know, how do bees measure distance? I said they do measure distance, they encode it in the dance. Inquiring minds want to know, how do they do that? That's what he wanted to know. And so he had a hypothesis, I'll make a long story short, he had a hypothesis that it has to do with how much information flows past their eyes when they're flying, as they fly through it, to see if it caused a predictable change. So what he did was he trained bees to fly through a tunnel like this, and when they would say, wow, that was really a long distance, they would dance beautiful waggle dances that had distance information. Whereas same bees, same colony, same food, change the walls of the tunnel so it's just blank, just white, or maybe just a couple squares, very little visual information. When they went into thinking, they flew further so that they would give us good dances, so that our video analyses could be done, so that we could ask, are any changes in behavior due to motor or just the likelihood, propensity to dance? And that's what it was. We saw no degradation of the dance. So, octopamine makes bees dance more. We used a fairly low level of sugar syrup so that we got very few bees dancing in our control group, just about 10% of the bees. The better the food, the more they dance, the longer they dance, and the more bees that do dance. So we got less than 10% of the bees dancing in our two different controls. The substance was dissolved in a particular chemical called DMF, so that was one of our controls. These bees were untreated completely, and you can see low level of dancing. But bees from the same colony and the same experimental apparatus as you saw before, we could triple the likelihood that they were going to dance. So the same chemical that makes flies eat more makes bees dance more. But the story continues, and that is, so these results speak for themselves, they're very clear cut. But what's not clear cut is the interpretation that I gave before, which is that it's affecting their reward system. Because while the reward system of mammals has been very well studied, the reward system of insects has, for insects, can't you just say it made them kind of hungrier or just something? And central to the idea, which I've been advancing, is that no, this is shaping the reward system. So there are lots of ways to go about addressing this. One way was to take advantage of a little known chemical cousin of octopamine, known as cocaine. Cocaine, why we use cocaine? Because its bona fides with respect to engaging reward systems are, well, for better or for worse, they're cocaine exists in nature as an insecticide. That's why it's produced by the coca plants. And it works to potentiate octopamine. So chemically it's related to octopamine, and yet it has these strong reward credentials. So we thought we would test it. Well, that's boring experiment. That's true from a pharmacological chemical perspective. But you know what? Stranger things have happened in biology. We wanted to see. Does it make them dance more? And as you can see, it does. So a comparable dose of cocaine also triples the likelihood that the bees are going to dance. And then we give the cocaine, it eliminates the effect. So pretty good evidence that there's a specific effect here. And the argument for cocaine allows us to be talking a little bit about this in the context of reward. So what this then allows us to do is think about the delicate balance between cooperation and competition, because the same chemical that's structuring selfish behavior now can be seen to be involved in cooperative behavior. And then one final example. Comes again from genomics, just to come full circle. So here's an experiment where we looked at the response, the transcriptomic response, so again, the gene expression response, to a honeybee in the laboratory actually having a meal for herself this time, not having to share it with anyone. So her brain's response to getting a nice, hearty meal when they're getting food. Two experiments here. One is a transcriptomic experiment, and the other maps parts of the brain that are active in these two cases. The blue arrows refer to parts of the brain that are active when bees are eating, having a selfish meal, and when their sisters are dancing. So there's a neuroanatomical overlap. Some parts of the brain light up for both. And then when we look at the genes, these, remember those circles before that I showed you about metabolism and so forth? Think of these as circles. These are giant clusters of genes, about 500 genes in each one of these, that are responsive to food. And you can see subsets of them, modules 2, 1, 3, 4, that are responsive to dance also. So just like we showed
these same genes responsive to social threat across species. Now we're seeing the same genes responding to a selfish stimulus, getting a meal, and to dancing. So these two experiments together make the case, in my opinion, that we're looking at me-to-we mechanisms. That me mechanisms, mechanisms that regulate selfish behavior, can also be used to regulate cooperative behavior. So, what are the lessons then? The lessons, of course, are bees are not little people, and we have to be very careful when talking about the relationships between animals and humans and how to properly frame that understanding. Genetic determinism has reared its ugly head in the course of human history numerous times. I teach a genes and behavior class. I start off by saying that behavioral genetics is a field that probably so far at least has done more harm to people than good. And that's a legacy of shame that we have to live with. But with genomics, I firmly believe we have the tools to be able to get it right this time and explore and understand the proper relationship between animals and humans, especially with these traits that we are so interested in, social behavior, complexity, and altruism. So they're not little people, but nature builds diverse social brains with common genetic building blocks. And then one example of that is a play on addiction and the reward system being particularly malleable and being able to be used for cooperative behavior. So with that, I'll stop, and I'll be happy to take more questions. Thank you.
We do recognize that some might need to leave and some would love to stay. We have refreshments here to my right, your left. They are many homemade goodies, including some cupcakes that have little edible bees on top of them.
I'm a sucker for those.
Make sure he gets one. There are not that many.
We have a gift of thanks
thank you.
To you and for coming and giving your time and your knowledge and sharing that with us. Why don't we just take about 5 minutes? People can get something to drink. You are welcome to bring anything into this area here, and then we will have some questions if you're willing to stick around.
Sounds good.
Great.
Yeah.
Thank you.
But we also find many genes that are different. And so we have not studied those, but I would say the answer to your question will reside in insights that we gain from the ones that are active in different ways. And we don't know what they are now, but that's how we want to do it. Just like as well. So that's we want to look at that. You know, both similarities and differences are important. Question behind you?
Yeah.
I thought of two things to ask. The first one had to do with something I heard. I saw a special on Joe Wilson, and he was talking about, I think he was called the word new social, EU social. Mm-hmm. And new social, the honeybees were then humans, and mostly insects. There weren't that many species that he was categorizing, but I think altruism was in all of those species. I was just verifying because
So honeybees are
the missing punchline, if you will, which is here we are, we're humans, we apparently have to do. Why is it used more? What any speculations on stuff like that? I know we're much more complex. Mm-hmm.
So when you say why isn't it, which it do you mean?
The altruism tendency, mm-hmm. if we have it as human beings, why don't we use it more?
Mm-hmm. Well, that's
obviously honeybees are using it for survival.
Yeah.
We obviously do not need it for survival.
I don't know. I'm not sure if the jury's out on if we know that for sure. Certainly some day-to-day activities.
human society shows a lot of altruism. So I think it might be a matter of degree and kind, and on a good day or a bad day, or depending on which candidate you listen to, or so forth. Social insects have a much more rigid social life in which altruism is really just programmed in. So there are many fewer flexible points in insect society than in human society. But it's not to say that there aren't any at all. So we've done some other work where we have taken advantage of the fact that if you remove the queen, so I didn't talk about the queen at all tonight, just to focus on the worker bees. If you remove the queen and then remove all the baby bees, some of the workers will actually develop their own ovaries and lay eggs. So you mentioned eusociality, eusocial. What that means is that there's a division of labor at a time in human history when we were very enamored of royalty, so we called her the queen. If the queen were named now, based on what we know, and certainly if she were named by our youngest son, who Rachel knows very well and took very good care of when he was young and good friends with her son, the name would be something like, "Yo, egg-laying mama." And that's, and in that particular case, his irreverence would be appropriate, because that's really all that she deserves. So when you remove the queen, some of the workers will develop their ovaries. When the queen is there, the ovaries are inhibited, and that's one of the measures and characteristics of eusociality. When you remove the queen and the worker develops some ovaries, they become selfish. They start laying eggs, and they so it's partial. It's not complete. The eggs that they lay are only males because of the peculiarity of their genetics. Comments other than honeybees right now, but there is a delicate balance even in that society. So yeah, why don't we do it more? I don't know. We should ask our leader here.
You know, I am not a scientist, but I can be worried, not intergenerational, maybe transgenerational trauma. And for helping us understand that, because it's often viewed trauma as the nurture part of it, you know, what happened emotionally, but does that affect my dad? What might be some of the promise of this kind of work for helping us?
Yeah, so that's a really cool question. I just heard a great lecture on it in a conference in Uruguay. It gets darkest before dawn. So we now have really good evidence that there are some elements of animal trauma or stress that do show transgenerational effects, and in particular through males. So the sperm that are passed from during mating. And the evidence seems very clear, but the reason why I say dark before dawn is we see changes in gene expression that fit with this pattern, but there's no understanding of how, we don't see how those molecular changes can be transmitted. But people are looking very hard, and there's all sorts of other forms of RNA and genetic material that are being studied that are passed along with the sperm that could have the secrets. So I would predict in 5 years we will have an understanding of this kind of transgenerational effect. And it's really fraught, as you know. There's been pushback, for example, about blaming parents on their behavior is going to be setting up, their grandchildren for ruin. And there's been.
But are you also saying, is she also saying, are you also talking about trauma to an individual and the effects of that trauma can be passed on? That's what it sounded like you were saying.
What they use in mice are social defeat type things. So pairing them with a dominant individual so that they're bullied and badgered or they don't get as much food and repeatedly creates a syndrome in a mouse where it adopts a kind of a learned helplessness So it's like a model for depression and other things, and it's been used to study depression. That paradigm, you get offspring effects. And you can see changes in gene expression, but why, how those changes in gene expression occur is not known. It's thought, so the kinds of changes, that you see are called epigenetic, not changes to the DNA turned off. There's no known mechanism for how those, like Christmas ornaments that are on the DNA, how they make it through the various processes that you know, create gametes that are then transmitted to be fertilized, to meet the sperm, to meet the egg, to be fertilized. There's no understanding of how those adornments can be passed along. But the changes in gene expression are now seen and now clear. For metabolic syndrome, and the sort of just-so story was that somehow those that survived had to have a thrifty metabolism, and so somehow they turned down the metabolism on the offspring, and then if they don't have a situation of famine, but rather plenty, they developed metabolic syndrome, obesity, and so forth. So that epidemiologically has been solid for a long time. No one had any molecular explanation. Now we see it at the level that we talked about tonight, gene expression, gene activity, but still no understanding of how.
You mentioned that the IGB have scientists collaborating as opposed to having individual scientists. How is that similar to or different from collaborations in different types of labs?
So it's different that in different types of lab, the unit of organization is the individual lab. So two labs can collaborate. There are only 7 labs in the entire complex. And so each one houses teams. All the work is done in a collaborative way. In a traditional sense, I can get together, collaborate with you for a while, then I go back and do my thing, and I can collaborate with someone else, and that's the dominant style. This is people thinking of something that's bigger, way bigger than they can do as an individual, that involves different disciplines, and that comes together in that way. Yes?
In any sort of social interaction, there are sometimes cheaters, people that don't conform to what everyone else is doing. And I'm just wondering, are there cheaters in bee counties, or is there not? Because, cheating, since the workers don't actually propagate themselves, there's no advantage in cheating, I guess, not communicating with food, yourself, I guess.
Uh-huh. Yeah, that's a great question. So competition and cooperation are sort of like yin-yang, and, you can have extreme differences, and then there can be some fuzzy lines there. Honeybees, but they have a little conflict. So the best way to measure it is going back to the difference between queens and workers. All the eggs in the colony are laid by workers, but there is policing that goes on. Workers can distinguish eggs laid by one of their sisters from eggs laid by the queen, and will preferentially destroy those eggs. So there's not much in it for them, and that probably evolutionarily is what keeps it in check. Whereas other insect societies that are not as far along on a continuum, there's a lot more, and there's much more intrigue going on and subterfuge going on. So it's a continuum. Yes?
So how does the queen inhibit ovary development in her sisters, and how is it that some individuals are?
So she does that by means of chemicals that are called pheromones, sort of like perfumes. These are chemical substances that manipulate the behavior of others in the same species, which is the definition of pheromone, and also probably the definition of perfume. And genetic variants that are less sensitive to that. And in fact, you can test that and show that you can select using artificial selection, you can create strains of bees that are unresponsive to the queen completely by selecting on these extremes. There's always genetic variation for just about any trait. And another piece of evidence that supports that is that in South Africa, there's a strain of honeybees that the workers do all the egg laying, and they're completely insensitive.
and they actually are causing a problem in South Africa. They invade other honeybee colonies of other strains, and there's a queen in those colonies, and they're like oblivious to that. They just lay eggs, and they're not as efficient, and so the colonies die. And so there's a problem. They're parasitic honeybees, so cheating to the max. Yes?
So in bee colonies, how do bees in a given colony recognize each other as part of the same colony? How do you know that one from one colony is different from?
Yeah, so insects use a lot of chemical communication. They're really big on chemical communication. And social insects are really, really big on chemical communication. They mostly live in the dark, and so they have to rely on the chemical sense. And so they are able, you know, will give a characteristic odor. And they also can, there are intrinsic odors that are produced, and the more closely related you are, the more similar those intrinsic odors will be. And so how bees form a template, it's learned. We know that it's learned. How they form a template, where that template is in the brain, we don't know. It'd be great to study, because it's really a high level of recognition. I don't know about you, but you know, for me, I can't tell who's related to me unless I, you know, if it's a family reunion, I walk into a room, I say, okay, they're all related to me. I wouldn't know otherwise. Bees know. Ants know. Termites know. Well, you guys have been great. Loved your questions, and thank you very much for your